So our next presenters are going to be on a video, and they will hopefully be available for questions after their presentation, and we've got confirmation. So actually, should I be up here to kind of help with the Q&A? Okay, great. So our next presentation is entitled The Puerto Rican Tiple, Requinto Costero, From the Museum Collection to Its Revival. And the authors are William Cumpiano, Noralise Ruiz, and Norman Storr Corrada. Thank you.
Good afternoon. The title of our presentation is The Puerto Rican Tiple Requinto Costero, From the Museum Collection to Its Revival. The history of the Puerto Rican Tiple Requinto is one that is currently unfolding as new pieces of information allow us to closely examine for the first time to three Tiples Requintos Costeros, as shown in the slide, a regional variant collected in Ponce, circa 1899, that have been preserved at the Smithsonian. To contextualize the instrument, tiple performance is a less known category of the stream of Puerto Rican folk music, also known as jíbaro music. The tiple, in all its forms and regional variants, belongs to a native family of lutes, presented here in the next slide, along with the Puerto Rican cuatro, which is the 10-string national instrument, and the bordonúa, a guitar-like instrument with a lower register that, like the tiple, was overshadowed in popularity by the Puerto Rican cuatro. The relative absence of the tiple and the bordonúa from the local soundscapes during the last century makes it really challenging to revitalize and reinsert the use of the instrument into performance settings. By relative absence, I mean that tiples are largely missing from the discography of jíbaro music. There is scarcely any survival of actual instruments and limited preservation through instrument construction. In the literature from the 19th century, there are a few mentions of the instrument and its use. For example, in his memoirs, Alejandro Tapia y Rivera makes reference to the group gatherings that included singing and playing of the native instruments, such as cuatro, vihuela, tiples, and bordonúa. In a publication from 1887, Francisco del Valle Atiles describes the tiple as a small guitar-like instrument that has a peculiar tuning with the first and fifth strings tuned to the same pitch. Another publication from 1849, which describes cultural practices in Puerto Rico under Spanish rule, is El Jíbaro, Manuel Alonso. In his narrative, Alonso mentions that the orchestra included bordonúa, cuatro, and tiple. Because of the dispersed presence of the instrument in the literature and the few iconographic representations that are accessible, the rediscovery of these Puerto Rican native instruments from the Beckwith collection at the Smithsonian is very relevant as it provides a unique opportunity of learning about this instrument. Addressing the Puerto Rican tiple implies consulting a recent history. The current tiple performance and the body of knowledge that we have about the instrument is a direct result of revitalization efforts that took place in the late 1990s. The successful tiple revival granted us recordings, research and publications, and tiple learning construction methods. However, this revival was focused on just one variation of the tiple, the five-string model known as tiple doliente, shown here in the next slide, which is from the central region of Puerto Rico. The tiple doliente came to be known as the modern tiple, hence other regional variations such as the Tiplón and Tiple Requinto Costero were dismissed from these efforts, awaiting further study until this point in time. Last year, Norman Stoddard shared some of his findings at the Beckwith Collection, and along with the expertise of luthier William Cumpiano, were able to study the instruments and build replicas of the 19th century Tiple Requinto. But what do we know about the Tiple Requinto? There are three and four string versions of the tiple requinto and two sub-variations, one found in the coastal region and one from the mountain region. In terms of its playing techniques, It could be used to either pluck melodic lines or strum a basic chord progression. Using the tiple to rhythmically strum chords is a technique that has been called by cuatro and tiple players as floreteo, which translates as decorating or embellishing. The following picture also belongs to the Beckwith collection. It suggests that the tiple requinto was performed in an ensemble-like setting, along with the guitar and the güiro. Its role probably consisted of providing accompaniment for the voice and other instruments. The tiple had a role in both secular and religious music practices. Probably one of the most common scenarios was its use in the performance of the Holy Rosary, where it played melodic phrases within a call and response structure, and the recurrent and poignant phrases it played in the Cantos de Vaquiné, performed during a child's wake. In the performance of Seises and Aguinaldos is where the tiple is distinctively used. Seises and Aguinaldos provide the characteristic repertoire of Jíbaro music, which consists of hundreds of melodic lines with regional variations that often accompany a singer. And there are probably other performance settings that remain unknown and distant from the usual folk and street music characterizations, such as the one involving this particular group of elegantly dressed group of tiple players presented here in the next slide. Tiple players in San Juan, Puerto Rico around 1916. So the renewed interest on the tiple requinto manifest what Jennifer Post has suggested in reference to the Chinese Huqin, that musical instruments offer opportunities for reconstructing histories and for contributing to a sense of continuity in relation to cultural and national identity as tangible objects that enable knowledge, memory, and ownership of a practice that may no longer be in place, yet remains in the cultural memory of a community. It is our hope to promote this instrument and to reinsert it not only through its performance, but through its inclusion in the discourse related to the Puerto Rican family of lutes. Aware of the challenges implied in the practice of Jíbaro music as an encompassing concept that is charged with not only sounds, playing techniques, and a defined repertoire, but that includes ideas that touch upon nationalism, colonialism, decoloniality, and the struggles of cultural preservation and education. It is a challenging task ahead of us, and we're excited about continuing this conversation. Now, Norman Storer Corrada will discuss in more detail the Puerto Rican instruments from the Beckwith collection at the Smithsonian.
Thank you very much, Noralee.
Thank you.
So now that we have contextualized the tiple requinto costero within the wider family of Puerto Rican instruments and Puerto Rican musicology, I want to talk a little bit about the specific context of the three tiples at the National Museum of Natural History. So I first learned about these instruments while I was conducting a fellowship at the Smithsonian. And it just so happens that the Smithsonian has one of the largest collections of late 19th and early 20th century Puerto Rican string instruments. And this is through two main collections. One is the Paul Beckwith collection, which I will talk about in a second, and the other, the Dolores Vidal collection. There are other early Puerto Rican string instruments at the Met and at the Musical Instrument Museum in Phoenix, Arizona, but very few remain in Puerto Rico, and most are in private collections, which represents challenges for access for researchers in Puerto Rico. I first saw another instrument in the Beckwith collection, Cuatro Antiguo, an old style cuatro that's actually in the National Museum of American History. And curatorial assistant Ashley Mayor pointed me in the direction of the other tiples in the National Museum of Natural History. And it wasn't until recently that many of these instruments were digitized and made available online. The Cuatro Antiguo, for example, that image was not published until 2020, 2021. So it's for a long time, these instruments were inaccessible and unknown for researchers on the island. So how did they end up in the Smithsonian? Well, in 1898, right in the aftermath of the Spanish-Cuban-American War, the Smithsonian sent Paul Beckwith, an assistant curator with experience in mining, anthropology, and in some military experience, to Puerto Rico in order to secure relics of the war and collect historical objects as well as objects of daily life related to the people of Puerto Rico. This was the first wave of research. Beckwith was planning this trip when the Spanish hadn't even left Puerto Rico yet after the war. So this was the part of the first wave of anthropologists who were trying to understand this new colony that had just become part of the United States. Beckwith was there from November 3rd, 1898 to January 1899. He spent about half of this time in Ponce and the surrounding areas, half of the time in San Juan, and then returned to the U.S. via Santiago. He traveled up the Central Road and took many photographs, which are part of the collection, and Jorge Luani has actually written about them extensively. Beckwith collected military objects and other historical objects associated with the Spanish, especially. He also collected ethnographic objects, so household utensils, clothing, toys, and of course, musical instruments. And he also collected archaeological artifacts, as well as his photographs. The collection is split between the National Museum of American History and the National Museum of Natural History. And actually, five boxes of materials never made it back to the United States from Puerto Rico. So those were lost back in 1898. But the collection is still extensive. And it's a collection that reflects a lot of the issues in anthropology at the time, the colonial practices, and it reflects the inequalities that existed both in the U.S. and Puerto Rico. Beckwith collaborated with wealthy white men while in Puerto Rico, while only representing poor Puerto Ricans and other Puerto Ricans of color, mixed race Puerto Ricans, representing them as some sort of exotic other, while at the same time invisibilizing the experiences and heritage of Black Puerto Ricans and Afro-Puerto Rican heritage. And Jorge Luani and Amanda Guzman have both written extensively about this, and I recommend their work very highly. And so let's talk about the instruments themselves. We first started working with these instruments virtually based on measurements that were available online, as well as some archival work. And more recently, I've had a chance to study them up close, which will inform some of the future work that we do. So one of the instruments is this three-string variation. The three strings are of the same diameter. We suspect this might be the tipla that was used in this photograph, although it was modified or broken at some point. So you can see the top half of the soundboard is missing. It was equipped with six, possibly seven frets at some point. And it may have used a fourth string at some point, but it looks like it was mostly used with three strings. Another example is a four-string instrument. The first, second, and fifth, and fourth strings are of the same gauge, with the third string being thicker, which suggests a reentrant tuning, possibly similar to a ukulele in terms of the intervals. This instrument, the most salient feature is this emblem that we've been trying to identify to no avail. So if anyone has any idea of what this could be, looks like it was probably off of a cigar wrap or a cigar box or some other product of the sort, and then it was pasted on the instrument. And last but not least, we have the actual tipla that inspired William Cumpiano's reconstructions. This one is smaller than the other two, although the string gauges are the same as the last instrument, which suggests that this was an intentional choice by the musicians. This was is an established pattern in order to get the proper tuning. This instrument had fewer frets, possibly three, four. They were gut frets, just like the other instruments, some adjusted by hand since they were used at an angle. And like the other instruments, the bridge was carved from the same piece of wood as the soundboard, which you can see clearly in this image. And the body was carved from the center of a log. And this instrument, as well as the other one, seemed to have been made of yagrumo. Certainly the top is clearly yagrumo, and William Cumpiano suggests that the body is yagrumo as well. Now I will pass it on to William Cumpiano, who will talk a bit more about the process of actually using these museum objects to reconstruct and create new living instruments. Go ahead, William.
Thank you, Norman, for that overview of the Beckwith collection at the Smithsonian. I had already been living and working in the United States for 25 years, making guitars in both the European and North American traditions when 30 years ago, I became fascinated with the stringed instrument traditions of my native Caribbean island of Puerto Rico. As a longtime expatriate, I had lost touch with my beloved island and yearned to connect with it again. Next slide. So 30 years ago, I teamed up with several other nostalgic Puerto Rican expatriates, and together we formed the Puerto Rican Cuatro Project, an informal research club that became a serious and impactful 25-year research project. We set out together to find all that remained, all that could be found of the early, mostly forgotten Puerto Rican musical and musical craft traditions. Before long, though, we found that the story of the origins and evolution of the native instruments and the music played upon them had essentially been lost to Puerto Ricans, having fallen victim to the island's long colonial history. These traditions had been historically dismissed and devalued, much in the same way many of the island's other artistic manifestations had been suppressed and eventually replaced by those of the dominant culture. Next image. Much was lost forever. Few relics survived the ravages of tropical storms, neglect, and termites. So imagine my excitement when Norman revealed to me the existence of a treasure trove of photographs and specimens of well-preserved, authentic 19th century Puerto Rican stringed instruments, up to now hidden from public view. But these preserved relics were distant and untouchable. So I set out to make replicas so that not only I, but all Puerto Ricans could once again hear them and enjoy the sweet songs of what was the most rudimental of all the myriad forms that the tiple took, the tiple requinto. And this is how I did it. Next image. I started with the high resolution front and side view photographs of one of the several tiples in the Beckwith collection, the one that was my favorite for its beautiful simplicity and its essential lines and form. Next image. I imported the photographs into my drafting software at 1:1 scale and expanded them to match the specimen's dimensions as listed by the museum. In this way, I was able to extrapolate all the sub-dimensions that were so crucial to the task of creating an accurate replica. Next image. The product was a full-size measured drawing of a Puerto Rican tiple costero or coastal tiple, as it was seen in the hands of 19th century street musicians of the coastal city of Ponce. Next image. I proceeded to cut the plan and side view outlines directly from a copy of the drawing, and with it, I derived top and side templates from acrylic sheet, which I then used to mark the instrument outline on a solid block of native wood. The species was caoba, a mahogany species long favored by island makers for this purpose. Next image. Traditionally, Puerto Rican instruments were made in the same fashion as medieval and peasant instruments in Europe and the Spanish colonies for centuries. That is, in the enterizo, or one-piece way, which started from a solid block of wood and was whittled and carved to shape, soundbox and neck and all, with a machete or a knife, and then was hollowed out. And later a top was added. Next image. Here we see an instrument shell, back up please. Here we see an instrument shell being refined by Nestor Muray Rizarri, director of Ponce's own Center for Folkloric Research, who was visiting my Massachusetts workshop at the time. Next image. We created three identical replicas, one for me, one for the center's musical music instrument museum's permanent collection, and a third replica for future sale to help fund the center. Next image. Cut out from the plan drawing, a paper template was made of the soundboard's perimeter, then used to mark the outline of the soundboard plate onto a very thin sheet of yagrumo wood, a native pale-colored, light-density hardwood traditionally used for native instrument soundboards. Next image. We see the peg holes being drilled into the headpiece on the left. And on the right, the rim of the soundbox shell is trimmed down by the same dimension of the as the thickness of the soundboard to allow it to lie on it flush with the surface of the neck shaft. Next image. The tie block bridge is fashioned out of a separate block of caoba. In the original, the bridge is integral at the top, but I couldn't do that because I would have needed yagrumo timber of sufficient thickness to fashion both the soundboard and bridge together. And I can't get yagrumo in Northwest Massachusetts. The next image. Here we see can you back that up? Here we see the sound hole cut out of the yagrumo soundboard plate with a separate bridge already adhered in place, waiting to be glued to the open rim of the soundbox. You can change it now, please. On the left, we see that a platen with a clearance hole for the bridge is placed over the soundboard during gluing to allow the clamping pressure to spread evenly around the soundbox rim until the glue dried. And then on the right, the completed soundbox is finished with paste wax, which approximated the beeswax or melted candle wax that was most likely used to seal the original's surfaces. Next image. I fashioned a set of simple taper pegs from 3/4-inch poplar dowels that matched the originals in size and appearance. Cotton string was looped around the neck shaft to simulate the original tied frets. Next image. Although it's more likely the original tied frets were spaced by trial and error, I relied on the more accurate rule of 18 to space them and then made little notches at the corners to hold and return them to position should they stray. Next image. On the left, I was fortunate enough to have a gut string maker nearby in Cambridge, Massachusetts that I consulted and recommended a set of gauges appropriate to the instrument's string length, range, and set of pitch intervals. Nylon was not an option. Next image. The bone saddle is notched to separate the strings and hold them at the appropriate height off the surface of the fretboard. Next image. Here the tiple utters its first sounds. I imagined it as a kind of time machine, allowing an auditory window into a long lost world, an utterance silenced for over a century. Can I have the next image? Here we have some views of the completed replica. Next image. Next image. Shortly after it was completed, two instruments were placed on public display at the Ponce Music Museum. They now form part of the permanent collection of the Center for Folkloric Research in the same city. And that's about it. I understand that now Dr. Nodaliz Ruiz will grace us with a short performance of the Tiple Requinto Costero, silenced for over a century.
Questions from the audience. I'll start. I'm curious what kind of the next phase of this project is. Is there going to be an exhibition or a publication or a digital project to show your findings and the replicas, et cetera?
So we started with this project in collaboration with Casa Paoli in Ponce, and we had the exhibition in December. So we will continue to collaborate with that institution. And I think that they have on schedule a TIPLE construction workshop under the guidance of William Compiano as well for young folks aspiring to learn how to make these instruments.
Great. We have a question from Jason.
Okay. Hello, thank you. I'm curious, did the Smithsonian provide additional support, or was all of the information that you took to build the instruments from the website?
So initially, and this is Norman speaking, so we initially obtained the information from the website. Part of that was just constraints from the pandemic. I was able to carry out some archival research very early on in 2019, but then until really a few months ago, we couldn't access the instruments. So a lot of the work was just done online and through correspondence, but I was also able to complete an internship. Actually, I'm still doing an internship at the National Museum of American History, and that has given me additional opportunities to continue this research and also improve some of the object records for these instruments. And I was able to also study them up close, get some additional measurements that weren't available on the website, like the string gauges when these were first built. So that would be an additional next step, going back to the first question, incorporating some of these more recent findings in any future reconstructions of the instruments.
Got a question from Stella.
This question is for Norman. Hey, it's Stella. In your time at the Smithsonian, concerning the instruments that are still held within the collection of NMNH Natural History, have you heard any stirrings of those instruments possibly being moved towards NMAI or NMAH, or does it seem as though they're going to stay with the Natural History Collection, if you've heard anything?
Yeah, thank you for your question, though. Yeah, I suspect that they're probably going to stay. I've floated the idea of the instruments being reunited in American history, just so that they're a bit more consolidated, all in one place, cohesive, because it is a little tricky to go back and forth. And actually, we're still addressing, even correcting some of the object records, just from that there are still mix-ups from the original split. You know, the records got a little confused in the process. So they're still working on that. But yeah, it seems unlikely that they'll be moved. I think they'll likely stay there for the time being. They're also in offsite storage, but we'll see. I'll keep floating the idea and hopefully someone might pay attention to me. Another idea that would be really great in the future, I don't know if this would be possible, but eventually returning these instruments to Puerto Rico, certainly at least exhibiting them in a traveling exhibition or on loan would be really wonderful, since they really aren't well known on the island. So that would be an excellent future opportunity as well.
We've got a question in the back.
Yeah, I was wondering if you could speak to the different forms of the TIPLE, and was this particular instrument designed for portability or you know, due to its size? I'm just curious, and if you could speak to the different types of TIPLEs in the instrument family.
I could say something about that. This is William Compiano. Our Quattro project has been researching Puerto Rican string instruments now for just almost 30 years. And we've discovered that there wasn't just a tiple, there was a multitude, a proliferation of tiples. And it seemed like every region of the island had its own tiple and its own tuning almost. And their tiples were extant on the island since the 17th century, perhaps. And we've found evidence of single string, two string, three string, up to six string tiples over the island of different sizes and shapes. but they were all smaller than what Noralis called the national instrument, which is a cuatro, which was a more advanced. It came, we believe, at a later date, originated in Puerto Rico later in its history. And yes, well, that's essentially what we have. Our website, the Cuatro Project website, has a much more expanded account of the what we know of the tiple's history and its music.
Great. Well, on that note, we are out of time. I want to thank all of our panelists for this session.